I'm going to talk to you about something that I live and breathe, which is the whole business of connection and connectedness. I run what is thought of as a networking business. It kind of is a networking business. I spent a long time trying to persuade people that networking was a good and nice thing, and to sort of rehabilitate and reorientate the way we regard networking. And to some degree, I succeeded in that. But I began to become more interested in the wider implications about connectedness, because we are in an age of uber, hyper, perma connectedness, are we not, when we are not just dealing with social networks, but the whole infrastructure of our lives has moved to be embedded on networks, what the management writer Francis Cairncross called the death of distance, that we are living in a time where the networks that we used to sort of have over there, or be the railroad and the infrastructure networks, are now embedded in our very lives and in our hands on screens as large as a slice of supermarket cheese. So we're in revolutionary times, and I think those times of connectedness need explaining. In a nutshell, I'm going to talk to you about two kinds of chips and why, if we're not careful, they're very bad for us. So on the left is a bowl of chips, and we know that if you have too many of them, it's not good. Although, interestingly, you should always have your chips cooked in animal fat, not vegetable fat. That's just a little factoid for you. And on the right is a different kind of chip altogether, a computer chip. And it's really 50 years, give or take, since Moore's law first hypothesized that the computing capacity would double every 2 years. And as a sign of the times, that computing capacity ran out a couple of years ago. We've sort of reached, arguably, a form of peak connection. So basically, what this talk is about is the health, or lack of it, of the state of modern connectedness that we find ourselves in, and to put to you that there is a way of understanding and navigating and negotiating through this age of overload, which is by embracing what I call social health. But at its simplest, good chips and bad chips, and chips in moderation. When I wrote my book, which is, it's kind of mainstream, but it's also a business book. Of course, all business books need to have models. And I wanted a model, a number, that was within the cognitive limit of 7. And I chose the hexagon and the idea of 6 things, and I'm going to talk to you about 6 things, not just to be gimmicky, and not just because 6 is within the cognitive limit that we can all just about hold in our overstuffed heads, but for another couple of reasons. One is that the honeybee is the most productive species on the planet. And one of the problems of this age of connectedness that we find ourselves in is that, in fact, it's not that productive. I mean, the ONS has reported a tiny little rise in productivity in the last quarter, but really productivity globally is stagnant at about 1.2%, so it's not great. And stress levels are rising around the world. In fact, if you're going to invest in anything, you probably should invest in antidepressants, because that's a rising market. And there's 10 million days a year lost in the UK to stress. But, you know, the honeybee is very productive. And the honeybee is productive because it lives and works in the same space, and it builds its honeycomb out of little balls of wax, little circles. That's what most people think of as the shape of connectedness, is a circle. But what got me when I was really thinking through, am I going to go with the hexagon, am I going to talk about hexagon thinking, is this going to kind of look silly, or is it going to land, is I read a little piece in Nature that said that the wax does begin as a circle, and then it hardens into a hexagon. And I thought, that's it, I'm there. We've got a bit of hexagon thinking. So just to give a pattern to what I think you could think about, possibly disagree, possibly know about already, forgive me if that's the case, I'm going to give you 6 ideas, really, and I'd be very happy to discuss them or be shot down. So 6 sides to the hexagon and 6 ideas. The first is scale and speed. In a nutshell, I think that we've all been sold and bought vast amounts of Kool-Aid from techno evangelists in Silicon Valley that says speed and scale is fabulous and we want more of it all the time. And I don't think that's really completely true. I certainly think, and many of you in this room that use ethnographical devices know that sometimes the small scale gives you as much intel as the large scale. The most interesting example of this to me is that Netflix found out about the binge-watching passion through ethnography. They couldn't find that out through drilling into their vast data. They sat with teeny tiny groups and they said, you know, what happens when you sit on the sofa and one show ends? What do you then want to do? And it turned out that people said, we want to watch them all. So, you know, you need a marriage at the very least of speed and scale, but just to outsource everything to the idea of largeness is, I think, a problem. I was pretty spooked when Mark Zuckerberg said on the occasion of Facebook reaching 1 billion people in August 2015, of course that's now 2 billion, talk of scale and speed, but he said it's just the beginning of connecting the whole world, he posted on Facebook. And I think that's sort of loony because, first of all, we know there's a big tech clash going on against the big companies, but Facebook is understanding that you have to come closer to community, that to some degree, connecting everybody does not help you understand or drive society or even consumer behavior. So again, I think that Facebook, I could have used WeChat or any number of others, but Facebook is a good example of how, if you really go down that road of the mass, you immediately need to correct that in some way. So the way I would correct that is to frame it in the context of the princess and the pea. That tiara is the princess. I'm, of course, a good Jewish princess, so I like the idea of a tiara. And the pea, everybody, I hope, knows the story of the princess and the pea, right? That the prince knows the princess is really a princess and not some froggy interloper, because when she sits on a bed, no matter how high they pile the mattresses, she can feel the pee because she's connected to like quality, and then he knows he's found his princess. And that's quite a good example of, if you know, if you buy my argument that small is good, you think about the princess of the pee. So what do I mean by that? Well, here's some peas. Lots of peas and little peas, and I'll let's see if you are on the same page as me. So let's start with the large numbers of peas. 60 billion. Does anyone know what that is? What happens on a daily basis 60 billion times? It's the number of Facebook messengers and WeChat exchanges. 3.5 billion. Anyone know what 3.5 billion is? It's the number of connections on the internet. So half the planet has basically got access to the internet. I'm not going to answer all these questions. 6,000. What's 6,000? Put your hands up if you know what 6,000 is. It's the number... Anyone? It's the number of tweets posted a second. So these are large, fast, big, scale speed numbers. Now let's move to my little pea pod. All of these numbers connect every single person on the planet pretty much all the time. What's 168? It's a very small number. It hasn't got any zeros after it. It unites every single person, rich and poor, Eastern, Western, any hemisphere. Yes. Correct. Correct. How many of you knew immediately that 168 is the number of hours in the week? Right. The reason why that's important is because it shows how disconnected we've become from the real scale at which humans live, which is even Elon Musk is not stretching time beyond 168 hours in the week. That hasn't changed since the Sumerian calendar. And the reason why I really think this is important is because unless you believe, and I hope you don't, that somehow the future is going to not require the human as much as machines, you have to stay close to the knitting, which is how humans actually operate and live. And a third of our time we sleep or veg out or are really not functional. A third of the time we, I don't know, go to the loo or get dressed or multitask. So we're only really working for a third of our time. So that's a real small figure. 150, what's 150? Any guesses on that one? I guess you have all heard in some shape or form of the Dunbar number. It's the anthropological maximum number that humans, there's about this number in the room, right? That humans can sort of form societies and groups without fragmenting beyond that. Lots of, again, very ancient anthropological configurations of people is in 150. Again, that's not millions and gazillions. It presents real problems, as we know, for large companies with hundreds of thousands of employees. How do you, in fact, connect them and keep them productive? And the final number is 200, which is, you know, there's around about 200 functional nations in the world. So I just put it to you, every time you get seduced by the more, the big, the large, you do need to frame it against the fact that we humans have finite time, finite connectable resource, and that we need to frame what we do in that context. So the second is the idea of the hierarchy of communication. Everyone knows about Maslow and Maslow's hierarchy of needs, which incidentally doesn't include connection, but arguably connection is threaded through Maslow's hierarchy of needs. But whatever else we think about connection, people communicate constantly. It is the leitmotif that runs through connection, is communication. And again, I worry that it's been subverted a little bit by this idea that more is good. And therefore, I just want you to notice, first of all, that the World Bank, no less, talks about social capital as being a main driver of wealth. And in fact, 10 years ago after the crash, the first thing the World Bank did was commission a report by Amartya Sen and Joseph Stiglitz, both economic Nobel laureates, and both of them concluded that increasing social capital, increasing the sense of community amongst citizens was the way to claw back growth and prosperity. And so the context in which we connect and communicate is social. And therefore, if one was creating a very simplistic pyramid, you could say that the method that we are all telling ourselves we need to do so much more of, which is use social media, is in fact the least intimate and the least special way to communicate. What we're doing here in the room is more intimate than if this was a webinar. We're doing in this room, I mean, it's slightly easier for you than for me because of the lights, but we're doing what diplomats call smelling the room, right? We're noticing, you're going, you might be going are those Gucci sandals, and you would be right, purchased at duty-free last week, and you might be going, God, disgusting shoes. You know, you're making judgments face-to-face with yourselves, with your senses, okay? And that's fantastically powerful. Babies, if you give a baby anything, the first thing it does is stick out its tongue to taste it, to connect with it physically. The first thing a child does is scan you with its face. And so my point is not to say, and God knows I'm active on social media, not to say don't communicate on social media, but it is to say, please contextualize it, that it is not as intimate and connected, it doesn't foster as much trust or understanding as speaking directly to somebody. And even though that's counterintuitive when we're so short of time, I think it's the answer. Let me put it at its simplest. Next time you get an email, instead of reply all, pick up the phone. Do you want to have a cup of coffee? You know, connect to people that you think you're communicating with on email, that you think you're on social media with, but actually you're not. I think that you should rename the database the people base, okay? I think that the social six is a model I use. If you are looking in a very short period at who you're connecting with, divide it up. Group, it doesn't matter what you call them. This is not a specific recipe. But divide them up into no more than six groups and be honest with yourself. How many people are you actually in a relationship that know you and you know that you've reached out to? You need to start, I believe, thinking differently, much more holistically, in a much more micro way about the connections you have departmentally, organizationally, because otherwise what happens is it all becomes a bit diffuse, a bit fragmented, and the connections are weaker. And we're all in the business, in some shape or form, of trying to land, right? That's what a lot of your work in insight is. You're trying to land understanding. Well, your behaviors need to be landed as well. They need to be docked and rooted in something quite tangible. Generation gaps. I'm going to talk very briefly about generation gaps. But my point is that... So one of these is me, age 17, and the other one is my daughter, age 17. Remarkable physical similarity. Anushka, her birth date is 010101, and she very memorably, very annoyingly said to me, "Mom, in your day, were there cars or just horses?" I'm like, okay. Why have I put up this picture? Because actually, I think it's a little bit of a myth that there is this vast difference between them, the millennials, and the Zeds, and us, the oldies. I mean, of course there is, you know. I'm a perimenopausal woman, and she's a young woman of 17, right? Of course there are differences. But we are, to quote Mr. Shakespeare, much more alike than we're unalike. And I think that this age of homogenizing groups as, you know, they're one demographic, they're another demographic, is a bit misguided. We, as the generation above, say, 35, are facing probably greater challenges of using technology and social media than the young, who it's indivisible and osmotic. I've got five children, three that I grew, two that I didn't grow. They range from 13 to 27, and each of them is both embedded in their technology and embedded in their relationships with face-to-face. My stepson, who's an editor at MTV, he plays football all the time. My stepdaughter does a lot of sport. Our youngest, who's 13, what he wants to do is hang out with his friends. My daughter and my son, they're on the internet, but they're on the internet communicating. There's a very interesting piece of research that I came across, which I'm very happy to share if anyone wants to get in touch with me afterwards, published by McGill University, a psychiatrist and an anthropologist, really trying to confront this slight scaremongering that, ooh, the young people are being completely, you know, corrupted by technology, and saying, yes, there's an issue about the dopamine behaviours and the kind of wonky reward settings that mean that people are, you know, constantly, I do this, repeatedly going for approbation and not finding it and going back again. But the actual act of being connected all the time is what they call pro-social. It's actually healthy. And so my point is, there's not as much generational difference as we think. We're all in this mulch together. We're online and we're offline. This paper also points out, as if we don't know it, that if we really are going down the road of saying, let's worry about the young people, let's also worry about the old people who, at the same time that all these problems began, started sort of forgetting to do family gatherings and, you know, left their kids to the electronic devices. So it's not really the devices, it's the behaviours on the devices that matter. Final point on generations is, let's not forget that the innovation is often coming from the old guys. The bloke on the left is a guy called William, who's 80, who patrols the corridors of the Whittington Hospital in North London, just helping people find their way, talking to them, noticing if they look a little bit lost. And the guy on the right is Muhammad Yunus, another Nobel laureate who has probably the man who individually has helped more women than any other man alive. He basically created Grameen Bank, the micro-lending finance site. And he did that when he was, I don't know, about 70. So let's not, you know, let's not fret too much about the idea that the sexiness lies only with the young. So here's my big idea. I got to say, when I first started writing about social health, the hardback book is subtitled Surviving and Thriving in an Age of Overload, which is a bit Ariana. But the truth is, we weren't sure, the publishers and I, whether this idea of social health was going to be one of those isms that ends up on the graveyard. Do you know what I mean? All those kind of things. But the truth is, the opposite has happened, which is people really want to talk about and understand the idea of social health. And in fact, the paperback, which is out next week, is subtitled Social Health in an Age of Overload. And, well, I can't break an embargo, but, you know, I'm about to take on a role involving social health in the workplace, which is a big area of interest for me. So that's obviously me in the gym. Another little family snap for you. I hate it that everyone always laughs when I put up that picture and say that. I don't like, what's so funny? But anyway, I am very interested in the concept of fitness and wellness and connectedness. So I'd like you to put your hands up if you own or have ever bought a pair of trainers. Put your hands up. Yes. And have you ever bought or taken a vitamin? Okay. And, you know, do you belong to a gym? Yeah, okay. Well, me too. We are part of a $3.7 trillion global wellness well-being industry. That's a lot of trainers. It's everything from fitness spas to the very lucrative apparel business. And it's really only 70 years old, that business. It's really since the Second World War when we began to take fitness and wellness seriously. I mean, obviously it's much more ancient than that, in the sense that we're going back to sort of the Hellenistic idea of health. But the practice of it, the business of it. And it comes down to the World Health Organization, which is 70 years old this year. It was, in fact, enacted in 1948, but this definition was written in 46. It hasn't changed. And isn't it interesting that physical, mental, and social well-being go together? But we don't have the same literacy or practice around social well-being 70 years after social moved from really being about class to being around connectedness. I mean, the computers really were over there 70 years ago. And why is that interesting? Well, I think that we are going to need to start measuring and monitoring the state of our connectedness, like our BMI, if we want to be more productive, less stressed, have more control against basically an infobesity. We know about obesity. We know what to do to counter it. Diet plus exercise plus, sleep. Same goes for our mental health. And it seems to me that unless we do that, we're going to be stuck in well-being 1.0, which, with no disrespect, is really the mindfulness room in your office. I mean, good luck with that, but it's not really about changing productivity or engagement or any of those things. We need to move it on a bit. We need to look at what I regard as the bridge between physical and mental health, and it focuses around who you know, what you know, when you know it, how you navigate and negotiate through this age of overload. And there's a tiny little image of a social network model. The whole of social network science, which is really interesting, boils down to really not that many ideas, actually. And one of the ideas is around bridging and brokering and the value in diversity and space. And it's around what's called in-betweenness and centrality. Social health seems to me the glue. Who you connect with, how you connect, the time and the time frame is all about the health of yourself, your life, but also those of your organizations. And I write in the book about what happens in society when there isn't adequate social health. I would put Grenfell into that scenario. I would put police mismanagement of information into that. A couple more points. I'm going to run over by 5 minutes, Mark. So we've had this concept of the hierarchy of communication, of scale, of generations, of social health. This is about work. And a very interesting thing happened when the internet came along. 25 years ago. Bizarrely, at the same time that the internet came and everybody was sort of gorging on the oil rush of information, there was a flurry of articles in the academic journals around organizational behavior and around looking at deconstructed, distributed network behaviors in organizations that were more like the jazz ensemble than the orchestra. And I think organizations and individuals that have social health are much more like the lateral, responsive, fluid jazz ensemble than they are the rigid, siloed, everyone's got their own role, hierarchy of an orchestra. That's a simplification. Let's say it's got to be a hybrid between a jazz ensemble and a chamber orchestra. But what I'm saying is that when you look at the world of work, Magritte's famous bowler hat, which is bizarrely in the wonderful Magritte Museum in Brussels. I don't know if you've been, but home of the Working Time Directive and all sorts of things that affect the world of work. There's Magritte. On the other side is my very reluctant son, who was on work placement in Berlin at a conference we run. Look at his body language, like shoulders up, hate your mum. Roman is 19. He's soon going to go into the world of work. And the world of work has changed. He's unlikely to need to wear a uniform unless he either has no status or high status, because nobody wears uniforms anymore. But we still have roles in work, but those roles are increasingly invisible. So we know the world of work is changing massively, and we need to construct different behaviors in work, not least because the place of work is going to change. Most of the co-working spaces now are full, not just of freelancers, but full of offshoots of big companies like Facebook, trying to get more kind of funky and groovy by having a little outpost. The office is a problem for people now. What began as outsourcing and money saving has in fact become a cultural phenomenon. The world of work is changing, and therefore our behaviours around work has got to change. Some things don't change. Some things, in my view, shouldn't change. The business card. People are very snooty-patooty about the business card. I love the business card. I just don't think you should give your business card to someone that you don't intend to be in a relationship with, to follow up with, to put into your little social six. Get real. Have relationships with real people. Don't offer your business card if you're not interested in the other person. So we need to think about what we're doing when we work. We need to think about the health in exactly the same way. It's fine to sit on the sofa and cram cream cakes into your mouth occasionally, but if you do it the whole time, there's a bit of a problem. I feel like most people have more organization in their sock drawer than they do of their business cards and their networks. I don't mean to be facetious. I just think that culturally we've not accepted we need to think about it in exactly the same way we didn't used to think about our physical health until the culture changed. So this is about culture, not about, a quick fix. And finally, some practical points that implement what I regard as the core of social health, which is knowledge, networks, and time management. Please close your eyes for 1 second and put your fingers together. Just close your eyes. Just close them. Close your eyes, put your fingers together, and imagine yourselves holding a little piece of string or a little piece of silk or a little piece of rope. And imagine you just tie a tiny little knot in that piece of string and in that rope. And that is your reminder, like you might have a reminder that tells you to not have the carbs, if that's your thing, or the reminder that tells you what to do at the gym. So you can open your eyes with your little piece of string metaphorically in your head. Social health is the productive, functional flow of knowledge, networks happening at the right time. The most important of these, in a way, is knowledge. We are drowning in infobesity. Nobody can trust what they know. Most of us do not have a system like we do around our food. Pretty much everyone either knows of a diet that they might have tried or has a diet that they adhere to. Who has that same rigor around their knowledge and information sources? You need to read long and read short. You need to have a mix of news and views and zeitgeist. Why? Because that's how you connect with people, by being curious, by learning, by sharing, by knowing. It's a problem if you don't have that. And the model is the five a day. That's a made up marketing ruse. It's not real, but we know it, we follow it. It's within the cognitive limit of seven. It's five a day. So your not includes having a pattern and a system. And if you do nothing else, please do a mini audit in your head of what information sources are shared and handled. Do yourself a favor next time you read something interesting, send it on a link to somebody. Review your internal university of what you're learning and sharing, because in this age, you cannot do it alone. Networks. Again, you know, most of us have a terrible jangle and traffic jam of our networks. Review your networks. Who do you know on LinkedIn? Are they a friend? Are they someone you've never heard of in your life? Are you in a relationship with them? I mean, all of these things, again, need managing and owning. Why? Because otherwise they're like a kind of wall out there crowding in. Share who's on your network. Without a doubt, one of the most powerful forms of network are what are called dormant ties, people you know already. So who do you know? Don't want to sound like Donald Rumsfeld, your known unknowns, but who do you know? Who do you not know? Who do you want to know better? You need to move the idea of the network into actually having relationships. Forget the idea of networking. Anything that's got networking drinks on the invitation, avoid. Of course, that's ghastly. I'm not an advocate of horrible old networking. I'm an advocate of face-to-face connection, of doing less of the more stuff. Final point is time. I know it's a statement of the bleeding obvious, but coming back to this 168 hours, we have finite time. Why does it matter in the context of social health? Two reasons. One is that your diary and your calendar needs, in my view, to be treated like your body. Only put in it what's good and trusted. As adults, if someone else feeds you without your control, it's either ultra good erotic experience, you know, chocolate and strawberries, or it's very, very dangerous. There's nothing in between, because as an adult, you look after what goes into your body. Well, do we do that with our diaries, our calendars? No, we do not. Somebody else gives us the Monday meeting. Somebody says you've got to be in Reading at 2 o'clock on Tuesday, and then you've got to be back, and then you've got to be this, and then you've got to be that. This is insanity, people. Take control of your diaries. Reorganize it. Really rethink it. Read Tim Ferriss. Look at what Anita Roddick did at the Body Shop. Reclaim your time. And the final point is reframe time scale. Most of what goes wrong in corporate life, in political life, is down to imaginary made up time scales. We're going to do this in 3 years. We're going to do this in 3 months. It's not real. It's not viable. It's not productive. And therefore, it hinders you. There's no point going on a diet if you don't want to go on the diet and you hate the food that you're on the diet with. You know, basic cognitive science shows us a lot more around motivation. So time frame as well as time is incredibly important. So those were my 6 points, my 6 little B's of social health. Go small and slow as well as fast and big. Be face-to-face in a Facebook world. Think of generations in diverse blends, not in demographic silos. Social health, think of it as the new well-being and go wider in your thinking about it. In terms of work, think fluid, think dynamic, think jazz ensemble to the orchestra. And finally, if it's useful, if it's helpful, think about tying that knot, because we all need a little trick and a little trope to get by with. So thank you for your time.
Julia. What a call to arms. Thank you so much, Julia. I really, really enjoyed that and just sent you a text message to tell you.
Oh, good.
I was about to congratulate you lot, actually, on not using Slido, but you couldn't resist it. Right at the end, I had a flood of stuff come through. I am going to give preference to... We've got a couple of questions. We've got a good few questions, but I will give preference to those that are named just for the moment. So can I start off with Kirsty? Is there a Kirsty in the room who asked a question on Slido? There she is.
Hi. I was interested in the social sex, so the idea of categorising people sort of with increasing distance to yourself. I just wondered how that relates to the idea of so many companies and organisations who talk about building relationships with customers. So if you are one of those customers, where does that sort of relationship fit into those 6 categories?
Well, it's a really good point. The 6 categories are not supposed to be fixed. I mean, I feel in some ways I take inspiration as well as from great management thinkers like Charles Handy, but actually from the great pioneering game changers in food and cooking like Jamie Oliver and Nigella Lawson, who said not you must do this and then this and then this and this, but this is your larder. These are your toolkits. These are the ways you need to behave. So the point about the 6 is, if you've got 2 million customers or 200,000 customers or 20 key customers, you still need to dice and slice them into whatever modules are relevant at that moment. In other words, are they active? Are they inactive? Are they disgruntled? Are they happy? Are they buying more than a certain limit and therefore, you know, require a certain treatment or not? And it's really that principle of being clear that you need to own these models. And of course, I mean, many, many very, very successful companies do exactly this. I'm not trying to say nobody does it. Where I think companies often fall down is in their internal sense of who they're in a relationship with. Internal communications is a big, big problem. You know, intra-communication. Harvard Business Review has quite a good piece, this issue, on it. You know, how do you really engage with a large, mixed demographic? But I would say that Social Six model is really for individuals, that you might say, who is in my group? You know, if I wanted to say, it's my birthday, you know, or it was my birthday, or whatever, how would I access those people? Nobody has a single address book anymore.
Thank you, Julia. We've got a good extra questions here. Somebody came on under anonymous. I have got another named one, but somebody was talking about social network culls. Would anybody like to own up to that one? It's a good question. Yeah, this gentleman over here.
Hi, so my name's James. The question was about sort of with growing social networks, and a lot of people that I speak to will sort of annually take a look at their LinkedIn or their Facebook network and actually cull connections that they've got, and they're quite brutal about that. I just wondered what your views were on that.
I'm all for being brutal and culling. One of the things that comes out very, very strongly around network science is two apparently opposing realities. On the one hand, predictability and pattern is fantastically important and a big feature. And with that, behaviors need to have rituals and orthodoxy, otherwise it's kind of chaos. But the other side of it is random and serendipity. So you need to have a balance. I believe that LinkedIn, for professionals, is almost where anybody who wants to connect with you should connect with you. Your job and their job is to try and find a way through to actually connect off what I call the island of LinkedIn, you know, by email or by whatever. But, I mean, why not? Be connected, anyone that wants. You know, you want to connect with me on LinkedIn? That would be lovely, thank you. Facebook? No. If you're my friend, I'll connect with you on Facebook. I'd done a big cull over the years because everyone was everyone. Twitter? Again, it's a little bit more like LinkedIn. So I believe that one needs to have your own pattern and your own management, whatever that is. And because of the rapidity of the way the marketplace moves, I think one needs to review it at least every 6 months.
We're going to take two more questions. If I may, Julia, we're going to keep the answers quite swift. So we're going to just take those last two. We're going to take one from Sinead Jeffries, please, right at the front here. And the one to follow up, if we can just see who you are, it's Mark, who had a really good question about infobesity, who's over there. So if we can get the next mic over there, that would be terrific. Let's take you first, Sinead.
I was going to ask if you could be even more reductive than your six and say if there was one thing you've done yourself that's had the most benefit to your own social health, what would that be?
It's a thing I do called Techno Shabbat, which is every Friday.
I'm glad I asked the question now, I love that.
Almost without exception. I know, I'm really relieved I actually had an answer. Is every Friday at about 5 o'clock, I kind of aim to have powered down my inbox. God help you if you don't have a strategy around clearing your inbox. There's one thing that's terrible for your social health is millions and zillions of emails. Get rid of them, getting out of office. I mean, email is the big tyrant. So I clear my inbox and then I set the table and my husband does the cooking and we have a family meal. And actually, you know, sometimes the kids bring their iPhones to the table. It's not really about that. It's about the togetherness. It's about laying of the linen. I must just tell you briefly that Wolfie, our youngest, when I started this Friday night thing, you know, the family were naturally resistant. This isn't going to work. You know, they love it now. And he was on the headphones, on the Xbox, to a Latvian boy in Dublin. And he was about 9. And I heard him go, anyway, he said, it's Friday night now. He said, I've got to go. He said, because on a Friday night in our house, we do something with chicken. Pause. Do something with chicken on Friday night in your house? And you could hear this literal squawking of a chicken going, no, what are you on about? Anyway, that's how I do it, is I switch off, I have a ritual. I peg it around the Jewish ritual of Friday night supper, chicken supper, although I'm not remotely religious.
Let's have one really last question then, Mark, and a really swift one, and then we're going to wrap this up. Thank you.
Modern tech is the fundamental cause of problems like infobesity. I was wondering if you see a role for tech solutions in helping us manage that, like platforms that allow you to curate news sources. Are they helpful, or do they just make us lazy?
Well, you've packed a lot into that question. I mean, is modern tech the problem? Yeah, but no, it's us, the humans. You know, we're the engine, we're the drivers. Technology, you know, is just the instrument. So that's the first answer to the question, is to be discussed, that point about whether it's the technology. Yeah, I think loads of tech is really interesting and helpful. You've got a company that's, I think, involved here called Cint, and I was having a conversation with the guy that runs Europe for Cint. These are very interesting technologies that you can meaningfully say, we use this and it enhances, blah, blah. My big beef, just to end, is with the concept that fundamentally humans are less good than machines. This kind of silico view that, you know, really if we could all just, you know, unite the world and change humanity and blah, blah, blah. And it's really bullshit. And it's really important that we don't swallow it. And I feel very optimistic that in the end we are at this moment. You know, I've been banging on about this stuff for hundreds of years, and now this is my 100th talk on this subject in a year. We are ready, aren't we, to talk about and think about this new way of being. And it is exactly about managing this tension between the human and the machine.
Let's all take our phones up and stamp on them. Now, all together, are you with me? Maybe not. I want to say to the four people that asked questions, there will be a book waiting for you here, which Julia has very kindly agreed to sign. I want to thank you for coming in person to talk to us in person, for you in person to be listening to Julia, and say that she's going to be sticking around for a little bit, but thank you so much to Julia Hobsbawn. Thank you, Julia. Thank you.